Hello. Hey, it works. Good stuff. Good afternoon. Welcome to continuation of Journalism and Media Week. Hope you've enjoyed blowing things up over the past hour. And I can promise a few fireworks in this session as well. We have an inspirational scriptwriter with us, Lisa Holdsworth, who's based in Leeds, has written for everything from Emmerdale and Fat Friends, Midsummer Murders, All Creatures Great and Small, Call the Midwife, Discovery of Witches. She's in the middle of a Channel 4 post-watershed drama about a dance school in the Chapeltown area of Leeds, which in itself has been its own drama. We might talk about that in a few minutes' time. For 4 years, she was chair of the Writers Guild of Great Britain, which is one of the most influential organisations for any writer in the country, whether you're a professional writer or an aspiring writer, and former chair of the Royal Television Society's Yorkshire Centre. And as I say, an inspiration. Lisa, welcome. Let's start with the title you gave this session. It starts with the writer.
Yeah.
In what way?
So you'll speak to lots of industry professionals over the next week and join your course. Fantastic location managers, fantastic costume designers, special effects, etc. But nobody, none of them can do their job until I've put my bum on the seat and my fingers on the keyboard and written the script. Everybody works from the script. And so from the second I sit bolt upright in bed and go, oh, dance school. Which is not how it happened, to the final shooting script that's distributed out to the heads of department. It's all on me, to be quite honest with you, and the rest of the writing team as well.
Presumably, though, there comes a point where, as a writer, you say, OK, I've created the script, now someone else has got to go and produce it. And that can't always be easy.
No, but actually, if you always remember that television is a team sport and nobody's trying to make your script worse, they're only ever trying to make it better, and that's when the real magic happens, when you start working in collaboration with your casting director to find your amazing actors or your production designer to get what's in your head and is just in black and white in words on your script. To get into 3D on the set, everything looks amazing. To your stunt designer on Discovery of Witches, I'd finally got to write one of those tunnel fights where everybody's coming in from door to door and sitting down with the director and the stunt director and going, can we do this? Can we throw him through a wall? Yeah, he's a vampire, of course you can throw him through a wall. Poof! And that was great, it was fantastic. So going from what's been there, come to the end of my fingertips and ended up on the screen to actually getting it on set was a really incredible experience. And it's an experience I'm lucky enough to continue experiencing from being on Emmerdale onwards.
Do you watch your own stuff when it's on the screen?
I do. I watch it twice. I watch it first to see everything that's wrong with it. Everything that's wrong with it. The pacing, that line wasn't right. Oh, I should have said this. That scene didn't end early enough. I could have nipped two lines out of it, etc. And then I watch it again and I enjoy everybody else's work. The first time I'm only judging my work, and then I go, my God, that set looks amazing. She did a cracking job on that scene. She's made me cry. The music swelled up at exactly the right point. This has been edited beautifully. And that usually is the experience because we have amazing technicians and heads of department in this country.
Is that something you're part of? You mentioned music. I mean, if you're writing a script, are you thinking they should be using this track or they should be creating this emotion with this music at this point? Or is that something that's left to the director, the producer?
I know not. So I listen to Radio 2 all day, so my breadth of musical experience
huge.
Is whatever Vernon Kay's playing this morning. So on Dreamers Dance School, the show I've just made for Channel 4, I'd never listened to Afrobeats before or the music that the kids actually dance to in the show. So we had an amazing music director who found local bands. They're nearly all Leeds-based music that we've used. There's an episode that's set on a video shoot. So they found an amazing grime artist that's based in Leeds called Graft. And he let us use one of the tracks for the video shoot. So I know nothing about music. What I will put is the emotion. And writing on a show with dancing in, again, it was about writing the emotion. He dances solo. Nobody can see him, but he's dancing for his life. He's letting everything out. And then the music director and our choreographer, Sharon Watson, who runs Northern School of Contemporary Dance, took that emotion and put it on the screen. So that's where the real joy of it, when you've written something quite nebulous in a script. Sometimes it's a line reading, or the emotion with which the actor comes into the scene, or the humour, if they've got the jokes and they've made it sing. That's the real pleasure. On when I was on Emmerdale, Marlon Dingle, I knew whatever I wrote for him, I'd get what I'd written plus an extra 50% on top, because Matt Charnock, who plays Marlon Dingle, is such a great comedy actor and a great tragedy actor. So that's the reason that character has been through the ringer over the years on Emmerdale, because we know whatever you give Mark, he's going to give you something amazing back, and the audience are going to love it, and everybody's going to laugh, and they're going to cry, and that's the point of good television drama, really.
Talking of crying, I gather the first draft of your Dreamers script for Channel 4, you did 42 times at the request of Channel 4?
Yeah.
Is that a bit of a pain?
Yeah, it was. There's a lot of diminishing return. So this sometimes happens on shows. It's not, you never nail it on your first draft, but 42 drafts was extraordinary. And it's because we were kind of developing the show whilst we were trying to make it, which was the wrong way of doing it. So we were getting multiple notes from multiple sources. And as a writer, one of your big jobs is to listen to the producers and the heads of department, and sometimes the actor and the director, and have them tell you everything that's wrong with your script, and to not launch yourself across the table and run amok, even though I felt like doing that on many occasions. It's a good job I'm not trained in MMA, because there's a couple of people that would be in a wheelchair by now. That which is not a good thing and must never done that. It's highly unprofessional. Please do not physically attack people during your career. If you take one thing away from this session. But you keep going because I loved the show, I loved the concept of the show. And so every time someone came in with something new, and often you are writing drafts because you think, I know this won't work. I can say it won't work until I'm blue in the face and nobody's going to bloody listen. So I'll just write it and then I'll try not to launch myself across the desk when they go, not sure this works. And that is an experience I've had my entire career. Waterloo Road in its old iteration, I've written on the new one, but on the old one, was famous for the, let's just try it. And as a writer, you go, okay, yeah, yep, okay, that's a week of work, but fine, fine, I will try it. And then you'd sit in the room and they'd go, oh, I think we had it right the last draft. I know you had it right the last draft because I wrote the last draft and it was perfect. So it's that backwards and forwards. And I'm making it sound like I'm always right. I'm not always right. And often I've resisted notes or I've resisted cuts because you become very enamoured with your own writing. You think you're a genius and it's 20 pages too long, but they're just going to have to move the news and that kind of thing. And someone comes in and if they say it respectfully, okay, this you're going to have to get 20 pages out of this, Lisa. That's absolutely fine. And you have to do it. And sometimes you take the credit for someone else's note. You go, yes, yes, this draft is wonderfully short and sharp. And yes, we got rid of a lot of stuff we didn't need. Even though you've clung on to it and someone else has told you to get rid of it, at the end of the day, you still get the credit if it's a good script.
I mean, if you're writing for Call the Midwife or All Creatures or Midsummer Murders, you're writing to a known formula. With Dreamers, it was your idea. Channel 4 had commissioned, presumably, the drama on the basis of liking that idea. And yet they then start saying, well, you're not the best person to understand this. We know better than you. I mean, that must be difficult. Is that part of a writer's world?
Yeah, it is. And I think there are lots of... I've been lucky. I tend to be listened to. I've got enough experience under my belt. You know, And if I was that kind of person, I'd go look at my IMDb credits and tell me why I can't write this right. I would never do that. That'd be a dick move. And another thing you should all take away from this session is don't be a dick. So more often than not, I am listened to and I'm the senior person in the room. So it did sometimes comes as a bit of a shock when someone fresh and sparkly comes in and they tell you everything you've been doing for the last 25 years is wrong and you don't know what you're doing. And that was a little bit of what happened on Dreamers, and it was very frustrating. But I'm going to talk about the positive. What I also had was the production company Duck Soup, which is three incredible women who I knew had my back. And I had co-writers who I knew had my back as well, because we had other writers on the show. And every time it got a lot, someone would give you a ring or they'd send you a bunch of flowers, or we just kept going. We were all in it together. And that's the other good thing about television being a team sport, is there's always someone you can go to and go, is it just me? I feel like I'm going mad here. And they go, no, but we'll get through the next draft. We'll keep going. We've got you back. What do you need? Do you want to come in the office and write with us? Do you want to come in the office and take turns to cry? Which is what we did. I just can't go with it anymore. All right, it's your turn to cry. You have a good blub. Here's the tissues. It'll be my turn tomorrow. And talk through. And so much of writing is about talking through the ideas, television writing in particular, sitting in a room and talking about imaginary people and why they would and wouldn't do. The biggest arguments we used to have around the writers' table at Emmerdale was that character wouldn't do that. And it'd get very angry. On the understanding that once we left the room, everything had gone, but Marlon wouldn't do that, Zach wouldn't do that. I don't understand why they would. How are we going to get them to this part, this emotional point? And it's so such a strange thing to do for a job, which is talking about imaginary people and assigning truth and real emotion to them. But it is the fun bit. That's the really good bit. So on Dreamers, over and over again, we'd come back together and go, right, what did we love about these characters and what felt real? And bearing in mind that we'd also done weeks and weeks of workshops with young people to just get their take on what interests them at the moment. Not just dancing, but why, what do they feel the world is not giving them at the moment? How do they express themselves? All those kind of things. So we had this whole bundle of interesting material that those young people had given to us at Saturday morning during lockdown. We did it on Zoom. We were supposed to do it in person. But every Saturday morning for 8 weeks, we talked to young people about their hopes and their dreams and all that kind of thing, which was an enormous privilege. And so bringing that into the room, so that gave me a bit of steel to my backbone, because every time someone said, can we make it a bit more middle class? I'd go, no, because it's set in Chapeltown and we've just talked to a lot of kids who are not interested in money or status. They're actually, what they care about is their friends and their relationships and how they get on with their parents. And it gave me enormous hope for the world, just to get on my high horse for a bit. The way we talk about young people in this country is disgraceful, because there are amazing young people in every corner of every town, and we concentrate on, you know, the ones who do terrible things, when we've got intelligent, emotionally experienced young people out there who really do want to see change in the world. And so for every negative experience on Dreamers, and it was a tough, I'm not going to lie, it was a tough writing experience, I kept coming back to the positive stuff. And we've made it, and it looks amazing. And we auditioned 800 young people for the 12 parts. There's an ensemble cast. And we found some enormous talent. This is the annoying thing. We're waiting for our transmission date, because Channel 4, if anybody knows, has had financial issues, and that means sometimes things get left on the shelf for a little while. It happened in 2008 with ITV. They had a load of drama on the shelf that they just hung on till they could afford to put it out. But we are going out in Q1, as they call, so early next year. And I've seen the poster, so they have to do it now. They've made a poster. And I can't wait for everybody to see this young talent. This enormous exuberance, dancing, grounded. Every time they danced, I cried, because they're so talented and they're so fit, which I'm not. And it was just... So for every negative part of the experience, and there was a point where I think I was pretty close to the edge, and luckily I got COVID and went to bed for 3 days. And I may have made an RTS Awards, a super spreader event, by having COVID at the RTS Awards, but don't tell Emmerdale, because I think they'd shut down production for a day. I was very poorly that day, and I didn't know, because I was running on this adrenaline and stress at the time. So when someone said, I think, have you done a COVID test? Because I don't think you're very well. I was trying to do a Zoom and couldn't keep my eyes open. So I think that saved me from going into the abyss. So again, and a third thing you take away from this, when things are bad, get COVID. You'll feel bad.
Good advice. With dreamers, presumably at the heart of it are the human stories of the kids and their lives in Chapeltown. So could it have been set in a youth club, a university? How important is the dance school?
So where we started was, because for anybody who doesn't know, Chapeltown Leeds is a real tradition of dance there. So the Northern School of Contemporary Dance is there, and it's there for a reason. But also there are these half dance classes, half youth centres where everybody goes. And it's not about, I want to be on the West End. And that was one of the big things we took away, that not every kid who goes to those classes thinks they're going to be a dancer. They go to hang out with their mates, do something that makes them feel good and that they're talented at. And that was the heart of it. So no, I don't think we could have set it anywhere else. Those characters were very specific to that world. There are two characters who want to go on and see how far dance can take them in their careers. But ultimately, it is about, I think, a very unique culture in those classes. And that's what made it really interesting to write. At one point, we were going to put it in like a formal school, like Northern School of Contemporary Dance. It's very structured, and it would have become about the teachers and I want to get out of Chapeltown. And actually, a lot of those people don't want to get out of Chapeltown. This showbiz idea that we're all going to go to London, and I'm an embodiment of that. Everybody said I should have packed up and go to London. I couldn't bear it. Nobody queues for a bus. It's an awful place. So I stayed in Leeds because I just wanted to make work that was reflective of my experience and not some distant idea of what the North is like.
Was it hard then to say to Channel 4, if we make this, it's going to be in Leeds and it's going to feature kids from Leeds?
That was the offering from the off. And in fairness to Channel 4, they never questioned. There was never a, can we move it to Norwich or can we move it to London or whatever. Norwich, I don't know why we'd move it to Norwich. No offence to anybody in the room who is from our beautiful Broads of Norfolk. But it was always about Leeds. And because we had Sharon Watson and her sister Dawn on as choreographers from the off, it was never going to be anywhere else. And also, I was desperate to write something set in Manchester. I've written so much stuff in Manchester. I don't like writing stuff in Manchester. I want to write something in Leeds. And so it was an absolute no-brainer, and Channel 4 never questioned it. And also, Channel 4 do have a commitment, supposedly, to the nations and regions. They are supposed to be making stuff outside of London and thinking about that. So it ticked a box for them being in Leeds.
Okay. As it's bonfire night, time for some fireworks, because I think my story and script team have had a sneak preview that you feel a bit passionate about this.
Oh, God. Yeah, okay.
ITV. Advertising for a head of generative AI innovation. Artificial intelligence is increasingly playing in television and film, and the vacancy is for an AI expert who could act as an innovative and visionary leader for the TV channel, which the Writers Guild didn't seem to like.
So, I'm going to give you the Writers Guild line on this. We made a very strong statement about this, which is generative AI relies on sticking the work from other people. I know it's more complicated than that. It's not just, I'm miming sticking it in like you're putting it in a letterbox, but sticking other people's work into it and popping out something unoriginal, just a rehash at the other end. It will kill television if that's what television becomes. It's bad enough at the moment with reboots and franchises and universes. And I say that as a massive Marvel fan, but everything is now just becoming thin and predictable. We need the next revolution in television. AI is not going to provide that. Also, if they are sticking my scripts into AI and making money off them, I want some of that money. And no one is legislating for that at the moment. The copyright issue is horrific. And finally, this is my opinion. It's bullshit. AI is not gonna, in 10 years' time, we are gonna laugh at people who put their money into AI. Like we laugh at people who put their money into NFTs or bought tulips in Amsterdam in the 18th century. It is just a bubble. All the tech bros are getting excited about it. And unfortunately, those idiots run television at the moment. And I hope it means they all get tarred and feathered and thrown out of their office windows. Not realistic. I don't believe in physical punishment. I mean, I know it sounds like I do. But at some point, someone is going to go, oh, this is just like The Wizard of Oz. Don't look at the man behind the curtain. It's someone turning levers and going, do you know what we should do? We get rid of all the writers. We can just bung it all in thing and this computer will come up with it. And it's going to be an empty box. It's going to be like that scene in the IT Crowd when someone's holding a black box and they say, that's the internet, and someone drops it. It's that. And I think in 10 years' time, we will not be having this. Everywhere I go now, people, no offense to you. Everyone's asking about AI, and I'm barely keeping a lid on my fury at it because it's such bullshit. Thank you.
Kevin Ligo and Julian Bellamy, both ITV execs, had to come out and produce a statement saying we're going to replace writers with
AI. That's exactly
AI.
What they were saying.
Well, it was,
they wanted
yes.
someone to write an app. And you can hear the discussion of those two old men in a room. What we need is one of those things the kids have on their phones, like an app. Yeah. Do you think we could get one? Let's put an advert out and offer £95,000. £95,000 that could be spent on developing writers, I'm sorry, or in the unscripted world, formats, etc. It's all about chiching, making the money. And I've come back to Kevin Ligo's comment on Mr. Bates versus the Post Office, one of the most transformative television dramas that has been put on in this country. And the only comment he had on it was that it lost money. So that man shouldn't be running a TV station. And that means I'm never going to write for ITV again, but hey-ho. But that is shocking. It's shocking to think about our cultural life in this country that can be popped out of an iPhone, or when it does have such a massive social and political impact, lost money. Shocking.
I mean, presumably before the internet came along, when Google appeared, writers started using it, but was that comparative to, okay, we're taking advantage of the new technology?
And not a day goes by that I don't hit up Google for something I need for a script. I chuck a tenner a month at Jimmy at Wikipedia to say thank you for the Times. I've gone, oh, is there an illegal cheese? Yes, there is. Thank you very much for it. Useful for an episode of Midsummer Murders. Has maggots in it. That's why it's not. You're not allowed to export it. The maggots will jump in your eyes. Literally. I mean, can you imagine the day I read that? I went, oh, thank you. Thank you, Wikipedia. This is fantastic. Oh, what police ranks are. Or how you die if someone gives you arsenic. Basically, if anybody goes through my Google list,
you're I'm going to prison. Murderer.
I mean, I'm going to Belmarsh. Definitely. In an orange jumpsuit, I've got the cell next to Tommy Robinson. But that's different. It isn't. It's taking facts and then turning them into fiction. Whereas what AI seems to be suggesting, and no one seems to get a finger on it, is we can put lots of really great fiction into this and make more great fiction. Now, from what I've seen of the images generated by AI, it doesn't know how many fingers go on a hand. So how the hell is it going to do that? It's just, look, there are hundreds of books about structure and how to write a script and what should happen on page 12 and all those kind of things. But nobody worth their salt as a writer really uses them because I want to sound like such a tosser when I say this. It comes from there. knowing what a character is going to do and say, and how you're going to make an audience cry or punch the air or make them angry, it comes from somewhere in there. And I do think writers are born, not made. You can there's some people who could read every book about screenwriting and never be able to produce a good script, or they would be able to write a book about screenwriting, apparently. But it's true, you could do all the reading in the world, but if you haven't got that thing, and it's so hard to put your finger on it, that love of emotion and empathy and putting your characters in terrible positions just so you can get them out again, or safely exploring really difficult issues. Drama has forever been a safe space to explore things we feel uncomfortable with or we find upsetting of making sense of the world. A computer doesn't know how to do that. Also, a computer doesn't know what's funny. How's it going to write comedy? How's it going to come up with good comedy ideas? And let me tell you, there are no shortage of ideas. Every taxi driver I get in a cab with and I tell them what I do for a living has an idea. But the execution of it, the beautifully written dialogue with someone like Aaron Sorkin or Sally Wainwright, who writes this gorgeous, beautiful, funny, tragic dialogue. The computer can't do that. So it's not the same. But yeah, I Google everything. Thank you, Wikipedia and Google, for making my career.
I mean, let's explore that thing, because a lot of writers say an aspiring writer needs to be able to soak in everything around them. They need to observe everything and store things to be used as future characters or dialogue or plots. So with all those things happening around you, how do you know when you've got an idea that's actually going to be an award-winning drama at the end of it?
You don't. And until you work it. So the idea could be, so I had one this week, and it's about witches and three witches, and then something happens and these three women come together. And I won't tell you anymore, that's still eating my ideas because I think it might be brilliant. But that's how it started. And then, so my process is to go to a garden centre and pay for an expensive cup of coffee and a bit of cake and get my notebook out and start asking questions. I write a list of questions. Why are they doing this? What's at stake? What would the prize? What are their powers? How does it manifest itself? How do they feel about it? Just question after question, questioning those characters and why I'd want to spend time with them, why you, as an audience, would want to spend time with them. Anybody who's done drama has done hot seating. I do that without having to be in a black box in pumps, sitting on a chair. Like, yeah, hot seat me. So I ask questions and questions, and then you do think about the audience. Is there enough drama in this? Is there enough twists and turns? What's going to happen in the first 10 minutes going to grab everybody? What's the mystery at the heart of it? What do these characters want and what do they actually need? And so it's question after question after question. And development of ideas takes, I mean, it really is how long is a piece of string. So we were on for a year with Dreamers, and then it was sort of getting developed as we were writing it because everybody had so many opinions about what that show should be. But things like, you know, Life on Mars, it took them 7 years to develop that. Sally Wainwright had the idea for Happy Valley. It took 3 years for the BBC to commission it. So this idea that, you know, Fleabag had been on tour as a one-woman stage play and then had gone to the National, etc. And every time Phoebe Waller-Bridge sat in the chair and did Fleabag, I'm sure she found something else in the material that meant by the time two brothers came to her and said, we think this would make a great TV show, which it did, she knew how she wanted to expand that character. She'd inhabited that character. So development is not from, have I got an idea, it's a superhero, fantastic, let's go. It's hours and hours of questioning, going down blind alleys, versions of your script or your pitch documents or your treatment that are just rubbish. When we got to the end of Dreamers, we did some reshoots and I did some rehearsals with the young people who were on the cast, and we were sat around at lunchtime. We'd worked through, we needed a new love scene, so we'd done that. We worked through the scene, and I was sat with the three leads, and one of them went, is there a version of the script where I've got a brother? Yeah, you did have a brother at one point. Is there a version of the script where I have a baby? Oh, yeah, we did do that one bit. Is there a version, then DeMarcus, who plays, that is the most fantastic one. Is there a version of the script where I'm white? Yes, we did that for a bit as well. And so there was a multiverse, because there's 42 versions of that script, a multiverse where we tried things and gone, this isn't working. At one point, our lead character had a dad who was coming back, and it was a massive story across all 8 episodes, which ended up being 6 episodes for various reasons, and we just stripped it out. And it literally, it's the most glorious feeling when someone in the room finally goes, I don't think that story's working. And everyone else goes, oh, thank God, yes, can we just get rid of it? And so we pulled it out, and a story that we'd worked really hard on, a character that we'd cared about, just ceased to exist. Gone. Out of the multiverse. And so it's close. So that's what develops. So you don't know what's going to be a great idea until you start just getting that little, I'm engaged in this. I haven't given up halfway through development, because so much of development in the early stages for a writer is just you on your own going, is this a good idea? And I'll do some reading. I'll buy many, many books about it, which I'll read 4 chapters of, and then put to one side and actually start writing the thing. And I'll come up with ideas, and I'll keep going, and I'll find the world setting, and what's the period for it, and what does it look like, and what does it feel like? And then eventually, if you've not given up halfway through, and I know this is a rubbish idea, because for every idea that I've got to stick in front of someone's nose, there's 5 that I've gone, it's not working. They go in the drawer, I might come back to them, or they might get shoved together, they might become a storyline for another show I'm working on. Nothing's ever wasted, but you don't know.
When you write a script, do you always know the ending?
Yes, and I would say it's really important for anybody setting out writing. The ending can change. So on Midsummer Murders, whoever I set off with as the murderer was never the murderer in the final draft. Where there was always some point like, actually, it'd be more interesting if she did it. Oh, yeah, okay, we can do that. But I do write treatments and scene breakdowns, and every writer hates treatments and scene breakdowns. They're awful to write. They're a dead version of your script. She does this, then he does this, and then they go there, and that happens, blah, 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 blah. But by writing the mechanics of it, when it comes to writing the script, I can concentrate on the dialogue, on the character, on where I'm coming in and out of scenes, what imagery I'm going to use, because I know the basics. I know how we're getting from A to B. It's like going on a journey. I'm setting off for the Cairngorms. I know which road I need to be on, but along the way, I might stop and take a picture of a lovely waterfall or have a really nice sandwich in a service. A lot of my processes around sandwiches in nice places, in a nice service set. And a deer might run across the front of the car as I get close to there. I might run out of petrol. So lots of things might happen on the way, but I know I'm getting from A to B.
Okay, huge food for thought. Let's have some questions.
No, I haven't ever physically assaulted someone.
Hi, Lise.
Does this work? No, I don't think this
does. Oh, it is working. No, it is. Hi, Lisa. What do you think needs to be done to improve TV writing? And I've got another question as well. Should TV channels repeat shows from yesteryear instead of rebooting them?
That's a two-part question. First of all, the premise of your original question is that TV writing needs improvement. Rude. How do we improve it? So I think we stop commissioning the same old writers, and I am one of the same old writers. We find new voices that bring fresh ideas, and that is something that our industry keeps promising to do and then keeps half doing and then gives up halfway through. So working class voices, black voices, women's voices, gay voices, voices from the disabled community, etc., need to be brought in, and not in a sort of hi, lovely, you tick a box kind of way, in a I'm really, really interested in what you have to say and what you can bring to my drama. It's happening in some places, but not enough. So that's how we improve television writing. Should we repeat instead of reboot? I think one of the best things about the changes in technology over the last 10 years is being able to revisit old shows. And it's almost part of our television watching culture now. I'm doing a rewatch. I'm rewatching West Wing. I'm rewatching this. Someone said they'd rewatch Fat Friends, which was the first television program I ever wrote on. And it's had a weird effect. So Fat Friends was made 25 years ago. Set in Leeds, written by the late, great Kay Mellor. And it wasn't, there were no dead bodies in it, there was no murder. It was just about a group of women going to a slimming club, to Weight Watchers. It got 10 million without breaking a sweat when it first went out. And then everybody forgot about it. And it's gone back on Netflix and it's done really, really well. Lots of people have come back to that show who didn't watch it the first time or are a new audience to it. And what I'm hearing from commissioners now is, oh, I rewatched Fat Friends. Why don't we make shows like that anymore? Well, because you don't commission them, that's why. It's very simple. So going back to the classics and looking at them can make us remember what we used to love about television. And I love a universe. I love Marvel. I really enjoyed Agatha all along. I thought it was fantastic. I think it needs to be done carefully and not for money, which is a forlorn hope because everything in our industry is done for money. So I love expanded universes, but reboots are getting tedious now, and it's beginning to look like everybody's run out of ideas. And also, you can really damage your legacy. So I made the mistake of watching Beetlejuice at the weekend, and I wish I hadn't, because I loved the original. I really, really loved the original, and I don't think the sequel's any good. And there's a couple of shows like that. And also, the Fall Guy, I'm old enough to remember the IP that's based on. And I think Colt Seavers should come back from the dead and haunt whoever made Fall Guy. It's one of the worst films I've ever seen. It's awful. And that looked like it was produced by AI. So yeah, we need to revalue original ideas, rethink about what our audience wants, because the audience is changing now, they watch television, is changing. Just trust the writers a bit more and bring new voices in and give people a chance. And as I say it all, I feel like I've been saying that for 20 years and nobody's ever going to listen to me, I'm afraid.
Good question. Okay, another question? I got the bear with.
Thank you. I heard a quote from a Canadian actress, and she was on a podcast talking about actresses and actors and things, and she was going, seeing the same old faces is great, but bringing new actresses and actors through is a breath of fresh air, or it feels fresh and it's great because you're not tied down to something. Do you think that's something that needs to be seen more, or is done already in the industry, or is it that the same old actors are really good at the job and that you can cast them in things like that already?
Well, I never don't want to see David Tennant in something, or Sarah Lancashire, or Ryan Gosling for other reasons. But I also want to go, oh my God, did you see? I mean, I think the show that's the hottest at the moment is The Bear, and there's hardly. And now they're recognisable household faces. Apart from Oliver Platt, I can't think of anybody who really had broken through in that show. And now they're all enormous talents. They're going to go on and do incredible other things. They were given that break. If we don't keep breaking new talent, people get old and die, and then AI is going to have to recreate Meryl Streep or whoever, and it's going to be awful. Because they're doing it with Michael Parkinson, and I just think it's wrong. So, yeah, bringing new talent through, but there has to be an incentive for it at the moment. There has to be someone who will say, I want to find the hot new talent. And that used to be Hollywood. It used to be, I want to get Judy Garland on contract for MGM. Obviously, it didn't end very well for her. But I want to find the new Meryl Streep, and it not to be her daughter, even though she's a very talented actor. I want to find the new Steve McQueen or whatever. I want to find someone on screen who I've never seen before who absolutely blows me away. And it is happening to a certain extent. If you think about Zendaya, and all the cast of Euphoria, they broke through, they're going off to have big careers. if you think about Neighbours in the classic 90s era, quite a few of our great actors came from Neighbours. They've broken through. That's fantastic. So, yeah, we have to find that. But what's happening in television is the places where new talent would break through are getting thinner and thinner. So loads of high-end television. Apparently, $72 million an episode. What the fuck are they spending that on? So those big shows are getting made because they make you keep your subscription going for the streamers, etc., etc. And the little shows where people cut their teeth, directors, actors, writers, everybody, are going away. So we've lost Holby, we've lost Doctors in the last couple of years. They were places where lots of people started their careers and it was a springboard. If we take away the springboard, and I don't know where this metaphor's going, we don't get over the vaulting horse, but nobody gets over the vaulting horse. There we go. That made it work. But we are stripping that springboard away, the lower budget, prepared to take a creative risk and give people a chance, shows are disappearing. And that's where my concern is, that we won't get new talent if everything is $2 million an episode. No one will take a risk. So you will use someone you know is bankable. You will use a director you know will bring it in under budget. You will use a writer who is a household name. There's a handful of them. And it'll be the same people over and over again. I once heard Sally Wainwright say she had so much on her plate she was getting up at 4 o'clock in the morning to write. Free Sally Wainwright! Let her write what she wants and let other people write other stuff as well. There are other writers. I want to see new talent. We all want to see new talent. We just have been convinced that we only want to see things that we feel comfortable and familiar with.
Any more questions?
That was really easy.
Hi, Lisa. You're talking about how development is like a long process that doesn't necessarily stop when you would think. And I think a lot of the best programs of all time kind of developed series on series, something like Breaking Bad. But you kind of see in the Netflix era, these streaming services are very cutthroat with cancelling like multi-series, and they kind of prefer to do like 10-episode mini-series. Do you see that as a problem?
Yeah, definitely. I mean, If you like shows about pretty boys investigating ghosts, it's been a bad couple of years for you on Netflix because everything like that has been cancelled. It's been enormously frustrating but heartening to see the outrage from the audience who wanted to see that development. And I think we're getting the algorithm wrong. The idea that if you've not binged it in a weekend, then you're not a fan of it. Because for example, the third series of The Bear, I tried really hard to eke it out over a few. I didn't want to, it'd be like eating a whole box, I'm capable of eating a whole box of chocolates, but I don't enjoy the last couple. Last one. what I want is to savour and enjoy it and to, you know, take a little walk between courses and be really hungry for each episode. And I don't think the tech bros running television understand that. They don't understand the different ways in which we use. So that we understand, we know from stuff we've done in the Writers Guild that Netflix looks at lots of different matrices for viewers. So there are the completers, people who will watch it beginning to end. They won't watch anything else on the platform. It's just they'll go through all 10 episodes in a go. There are the butterflies who'll watch a couple of episodes of one thing. They'll have four or five things in there, what you're watching at the moment thing, and they'll flutter between the two depending on their mood. And then there are the non-completers. They'll watch 20 minutes of it and pack it in. That kills a show. So now, even if I don't like a show, I do watch it to the end of the episode because I feel bad for the writers and the crew. Because I'm not going to be one of those eyeballs that doesn't go to the end. So I think it will settle down. I think we've lost some really great shows in the mix, and you're absolutely right. When you sit down on a second series or something, so I've done lots of seconds that come on a second series, usually in this country, a very small team of writers come together for the first series, or one person writes the first, and then they bring new talent on to work on it. Those discussions about what worked and what didn't, and what the audience reacted to that we were surprised about. Ackley Bridge was a good example. What characters that people liked on the second series of Ackley Bridge are so useful and make your show stronger. And I could list all the shows that had a not very good first ratings for its first series, and then people came back to it. And now more than ever, people could come back to it. Because that's what the BBC does on the iPlayer. They go, right, if you missed it the first time, second series on its way, but we've just put the first series up, watch it, catch up. Remember that show everybody was talking about? Well, now you can watch it. And that's, I think that's the right approach. But I think there'll be a time when certainly writers and production companies might be getting written into their contracts a guarantee of a second series. And that'd be a good thing. Because it has, I mean, every cancellation has been a absolute knife to the heart for someone. And I know that one particular writer I won't name really did think about giving up after his show was cancelled. And I'm so angry because now Netflix keeps telling me to watch things which I've already watched and they've already cancelled. Like, why would I watch it again? So, very frustrating.
One final question.
Yeah, do we have time? Anyone? Back to where I started. I like it.
Hi, Lisa. You said near the start about having imaginary people but giving them truth or writing them truth. And obviously that's relevant for all fiction, but particularly if you're talking about sort of fantasy-type genres. And Britain has a sort of whole history tradition of being very good at realism and soap opera on the one hand, but also fantasies. So I'm wondering if you can say a little bit about that, the sort of the benefits of coming from that sort of more realist background and bringing that to Discovery of Witches or to other sort of more fantastic.
So my absolute thing of choice is fantasy and superhero movies. I love that stuff. But getting employed in it has proved to be quite difficult. So after I did Robin Hood, and I did an Origins episode for Robin and Guy, and I had a fantastic time. And then I went to Hungary for the rap party and watched a rough cut of the last episode. And went, oh, this show's definitely not coming back. They've just killed everybody and blown up Castle of Nottingham, so that's over. And it was very frustrating because I thought that doing Robin Hood had bounced me into the more genre television. It didn't. But I'm all right at writing school. I'm pretty good at writing school kids. I've done it a long time. But I'm frustrated that I haven't been able to get to fantasy. So when I got offered Discovery of Witch, I nearly snatched the hand off because... vampires and witches? Yes. I don't care what they pay me, which my agent was very unhappy about. I don't care. Whatever the fee is, I don't care. I'm doing it. And it was great joy because... So here's what I love about fantasy. Is that those who don't watch it dismiss it as, oh, it's all witches and fairies and goblins and shit like that. Ugh, I don't watch all that. It's not realistic. It is. It is about putting yourself in those fantastical worlds and thinking, you know, would I be a great mage? Or would I be a good wizard? Or how would I react emotionally in this situation? If Sauron was about to bring about the end of the world, how would I feel about it? Would I have the strength of character to make it all the way to Mordor, or would the ring corrupt me? I've now lost half the room, and I don't care. Would the ring corrupt me? Walking Dead, would I survive the zombie apocalypse? Do I have the strength of character? What would I do in that situation? What would be my plan? By the way, if you live in Leeds, everybody to the Royal Armouries, there's loads of weapons there. That's where we go if there's a zombie apocalypse. A 9-year-old told me that, and that kid's a genius, is going to be running the country at some point. So the joy of drama, again, is that safe space to explore really extreme ideas. Can I survive a zombie apocalypse? Am I a goodie or a baddie? And that discussion you have in your head is just, it's the true joy of genre television. Can I, you know, would I be a good vampire? I think I'd be a pretty good vampire. All those, you know, would I create Frankenstein's monster? Would I do that? It's been going on for centuries. We love that stuff. And so people who dismiss it are missing out because that emotional richness you get in fantasy is just glorious. Like you get all the emotional richness of realism and wizards. So there's nothing wrong with that. That is, it makes it the best, I think.
Okay. It's good to end talking about science fiction on the eve of the American presidential elections. Lunch, followed by more Journalism Media Week. But for now, thanks to Lisa Holt.
So, Lily.
Lily, can you boost me up?